Hello students, in the continuation of the pharyngeal lectures, today we will talk about the features of your oropharynx. Now oropharynx is also known as mesopharynx. In the last class, we have discussed the features of the nasopharynx, where I told you that nasopharynx communicate with the oropharynx in the lower part and the communication is known as pharyngeal isthmus. So now today we'll discuss about the second part of the pharynx, and that is oropharynx. So this oropharynx extend from the lower surface of the soft palate to the upper border of epiglottis. If you will see the nasopharynx communicate till the upper surface of the soft palate. Now today we are discussing the oropharynx, which extend from the lower surface of the soft palate till the upper margin of epiglottis. So this is the quite larger space, and this is actually the common passage for the air as well as for the food. Now when you will see the vertebral area which is occupied by the oropharynx, you will have the C2, second cervical vertebra, and the third cervical vertebra. Now here you can see that in posterior side, this is your second cervical vertebra. Now this is the third cervical vertebra, but more specifically when you will see the extension, lower extension of the oropharynx, it ends at the middle portion of your third cervical vertebra. So this is what is the extension, lower extension of oropharynx. The wall of oropharynx is posteriorly contributed by all the three constrictor muscles. This is the important thing. Anteriorly, the gap between the soft palate and epiglottis. Now there is a soft palate and this is the epiglottis. Now there is, you can see that there is a clear cut gap, and through this gap your oropharynx is communicating with the oral cavity, and this gap is known as oropharyngeal isthmus. Then we have the boundaries of oropharynx. So what are the boundaries of oropharynx? Anteriorly there is an oropharyngeal isthmus, and through this oropharyngeal isthmus it is communicating with the oral cavity. Along with this you have the base of the tongue, which part of the tongue is not visible. If you want to see the base of the tongue, you need some kind of the spatula so that you can press this convexity of the tongue, and once you will press this convexity, only after you can appreciate this part or the base of the tongue, which is forming the anterior wall of your oropharynx. Posteriorly I told you will have the C2 and upper part of your C3 vertebra. Now laterally, now in the lateral wall you have the important structure that is known as palatine tonsil, and this palatine tonsil, which is literally known as tonsil, present into the tonsillar fossa. So we'll discuss here the tonsillar fossa, but we have a separate lecture on the palatine tonsil in coming classes. Then we'll have the roof. Now roof of this oropharynx is formed by a communication, and this communication is known as pharyngeal isthmus, and through this communication the oropharynx communicate with the nasopharynx in its upper part. So these are the boundaries of your oropharynx. Now what is the tonsillar fossa? Tonsillar fossa is the most important feature of your oropharynx. Whenever you are reading the oropharynx, you should always have the concept from the tonsillar fossa. Tonsillar fossas are the paired fossas which are present in both the side of your lateral wall of oropharynx, and these tonsillar fossa contains the palatine tonsil. Now these tonsillar fossas, at the side of the fossa there are ridges, and these ridges are known as palatopharyngeal and palatoglossal arch. What is the name of the ridges? Palatopharyngeal arch and palatoglossal arch, and these arches are also known as pillars of Phocis. Clear? And they are formed by the underlying corresponding muscle. Now in this part you can see that this round structure, which is almond shape, is your palatine tonsil. Now in front of this tonsil you are having one arch. This is known as palatoglossal arch. Posteriorly we have one arch, and that is known as palatopharyngeal arch. So these are the two arch, palatopharyngeal arch, which is a posterior arch, palatoglossal arch, which is the anterior arch, and in between arches you will have a fossa is known as tonsillar fossa. Now this palatoglossal arch runs downward towards the margin of tongue. So this is the tongue. So when you will see the dissection, you will realize that this arch is disappearing into the tongue, while the palatopharyngeal arch is containing the palatopharyngeous muscle, and it runs downward and backward and ultimately disappear into the lower part of pharyngeal wall. Now in these two diagrams you can appreciate that first you have to identify the palatine tonsil. So this is the almond shaped palatine tonsil. Now to see this, we have taken a sagittal section, then you are depressing the tongue. Now anterior to this you have the palatoglossal arch. Now it is arising from the palate, the muscle, and it is going on the side of the tongue, and this arch is covered by the mucosa, and posteriorly you have the muscle arising is known as palatopharyngeous muscle, and this palatopharyngeous muscle is going posteriorly. Now this arch is not having that much of distance, but because of the stretching you can see this much of the large distance. Otherwise the arch is having something like this. This muscle is going like this into the posterior wall of pharynx. So you have to understand in this diagram basically that whenever you are doing the dissection, where you will find the tonsillar fossa. Tonsillar fossa is a feature of the lateral wall, in which you always look for this almond shaped structure, which is known as palatine tonsil. Now in the tonsillar fossa, the palatoglossal arch forms the boundary between the pharynx and the mouth. Now this is very very important question. What is the meaning? That till which junction we will call it mouth, and till which point we will start to call it as oropharynx. Now here if you will see that this is your, suppose this is your oral cavity. Now we have removed the tongue. The tongue is not there, and we have removed the palatoglossal arch. Now suppose this is the anterior boundary, which is formed by the palatoglossal arch. So till this palatoglossal arch, till the palatoglossal arch, the anterior portion is known as oral cavity, and behind this palatoglossal arch till the pharynx, posterior wall of the pharynx, we will label it as a oropharynx. So you have to understand that tonsillar fossa is not a feature of oral cavity. Tonsillar fossa is a feature of oropharynx. Clear? So what I mean to say is that you have the oral cavity that will continue with the oropharynx, and the line of demarcation between the oral cavity and oral pharynx is your anterior arch of the tonsillar fossa, that is known as palatoglossal arch. So tonsillar fossa lies behind this arch, not anterior to the arch. So because of this reason, the tonsillar fossa which is present here is become contained of oropharynx, not oral cavity. Clear? Then the palate, that's why the written here is that the palatine tonsil, the lingual tonsil. Palatine tonsil means this tonsil is known as palatine tonsil. Lingual tonsil means the tonsil which is present on the posterior or the base of the tongue. And the valicula. Valicula is a space which is present in front of the epiglottis. All of three become contained of oropharynx, not oral cavity. So when you are labeling anatomically the contents of oral cavity, you cannot label the palatine tonsil and lingual tonsil as a content of oral cavity. They are known as content of oropharynx, because the line of demarcation between the oral cavity and oropharynx is anterior pillar of tonsillar fossa, which is formed by palatoglossal arch. The floor of the fossa, that means the lateral wall. The lateral wall, here you can see that lateral wall where you can see the tonsil. Now where is the tonsil? Now this is the tonsil. Now this muscle which is arising from the pterygomandibular raphes, the superior constrictor which is going posteriorly. In the lower part of the superior constrictor, you can see that on inner surface you are having this tonsil. So it is very clear that the outer wall of oropharynx is formed by lower portion of superior constrictor. Now these are the two diagrams where you can appreciate that this is the anterior arch. Now this anterior arch is known as palatoglossal arch. This is the uvula, which you can see in the midline structure when you will open the mouth in front of the mirror. Then you will have the arch which is going posteriorly. This is your palatopharyngeal arch. Now, between the palatoglossal and the palatopharyngeal arch, you will have the tonsillar fossa where we have the palatine tonsil. Now, this arch, which is actually known as palatoglossal arch, is an important landmark which divides the oral cavity from oropharynx. So, this is the important thing, and that's why this tonsil, which is present here in the posterior part of the tongue, this is space between the tongue and epiglottis, which is known as valacula, and the tonsil, which is behind this arch, all these three structures become the contained of oropharynx. Now, the palatine tonsil, which are literally known as tonsil, are the large collection of the lymphoid tissue which projects into the oropharynx from the tonsillar fossa. Now, here you can see the view from the superior side after cutting the maxilla. Now, when you are seeing this from the superior side, you can see the tongue. Now, this is the posterior part of the tongue where you can see the roughness produced by the lymphoid follicles or lingual tonsil. Now, behind the tonsil, you are able to see that this is the epiglottis. This is the epiglottis. Now, below the epiglottis, you are having the larynx. So, you can see these are the vocal cords and this is the larynx. But the important thing which you have to understand here, that when you will see the margins of your tonsillar fossa, which is important to understand here, that this is your anterior margin of tonsillar fossa, which is formed by the connection between the palate and tongue, is known as palatoglossal arch. Now, this is the cut section of the palatopharyngeal arch, and in between that you will have this pink color structure is known as palatine tonsil. So, palatine tonsil become the part of oropharynx because this palatoglossal arch is dividing this whole part into the oral cavity and oropharynx. So, in the oropharynx you will have the palatine tonsil. You will have these spaces between the epiglottis and the posterior part of the tongue, which are known as valacula. So, these are the important concepts which you have to keep in mind. What is valacula? And it is a part of the oral cavity or oropharynx. Now, the valacula is more specifically, we will talk that they lies between the epiglottis and posterior or the base of the tongue. So, in this diagram, you can see that this is the base of tongue, this is epiglottis, and in between that you will have a gap, and this gap is known as valacula. So, they are the shallow fossa. These are the fossa which are shallow. They are separated by median glossoepiglottic fold. So, median glossoepiglottic fold means that you are having the two valaculas, and these two valaculas are separated by a single unpaired midline fold, that is known as median glossoepiglottic. Glosso means tongue, epiglottic means epiglottis. So, there is a connection between the tongue and the epiglottis, is known as median glossoepiglottic fold, and laterally it is supported by lateral glossoepiglottic fold. So, you will have a three connection between the tongue and the epiglottis: lateral glossoepiglottic fold and unpaired midline median glossoepiglottic fold. The nerve supply of this area is by internal laryngeal nerve. Now, in this diagram, you can appreciate the all three folds. Now, this is your lateral glossoepiglottic folds, and this is your median glossoepiglottic fold. Now, this gap is known as valacula. Now, this is actually the clinical importance, that when we are doing the direct laryngoscopy, the anesthetist or the ENT surgeon put the end of the laryngoscope into these spaces which are known as valacula, and when they will pull the laryngoscope, the inlet of the larynx become clearly visible. Then you will have the next is oropharyngeal isthmus. Now, what is oropharyngeal isthmus? It is a communication between the oral cavity and your oropharynx. And what is the boundary between the oral cavity and oropharynx? Answer is your anterior pillar of tonsillar fossa, that is known as palatoglossus muscle. So, this palatoglossus muscle, which is forming the boundary between the oral cavity and the oropharynx, is become important part in the formation of oropharyngeal isthmus. So, when you will see the boundaries, superiorly it is bounded by the soft palate. You can see that this area is known as oropharyngeal isthmus, where superiorly you will have the soft palate. Then What else? On the lower part, inferiorly. Inferiorly, you will have the tongue. Now, tongue is here. So, this is the inferior part. Now, we'll see the sides. Now, what part or what pillar will contribute in the sides? Anterior pillar or posterior pillar? Now, see, I am saying again and again that anterior pillars are the pillars. Those are actually limiting the posterior part of the oral cavity and anterior part of your oropharynx. So, that anterior pillar become the gate. They are actually working as a door. When this door will close, your connection between the oropharynx and oral cavity will cut. When the door will open, then the food will enter into the oropharynx. So, the lateral wall on each side is formed by these anterior pillar or palatoglossal arch of tonsillar fossa. So, this is important to understand that why we are using the word anterior pillar or palatoglossal arch as a posterior limit of oral cavity, because these arches are forming the oropharyngeal isthmus or working as a gate. So, the approximation of these arch close the oropharyngeal isthmus, and it is essential to prevent the regurgitation of the food back into the oral cavity. So, when the food will come here, now the next step is we want the food to enter into the esophagus. So, at that time we want to prevent this food into the nasopharynx and back into the oral cavity. So, here you will have this pharyngeal isthmus that will close, and at the same time this oropharyngeal isthmus will also close. So, ultimately the food is having only one option to go downward into the esophagus. Then the last part is the gag reflex. What is the gag reflex? It is very important concept to understand. Whenever you are having the word reflex, we are having the two part, afferent limb of the reflex and efferent limb of the reflex. So, when you will stimulate the vomiting with keeping the finger deep into the base of the tongue, or you are stimulating the posterior pharyngeal wall, the sensations are carried by the glossopharyngeal nerve. So, the afferent limb of the gag reflex is formed by the glossopharyngeal nerve, which is sensory in this area. While the motor response is coming from the pharyngeal branch of the vagus nerve, and I already told you in my class of the nerve supply of the pharynx that this pharyngeal branch of the vagus is actually carrying the fibers of the cranial part of the accessory nerve. So, when you are doing or performing the gag reflex, you are basically checking the 9th, 10th and as well as 11th cranial nerve simultaneously. Because the 9th is sensory to the reflex from the pharyngeal wall, base of tongue and tonsillar pillar, while the cranial root of the 11th joins the vagus to supply the muscles which are present into the pharynx. So, at the end of this gag reflex, you should realize that the person is having the problem with the afferent component or efferent component. So, at the end of this class of the oropharynx, what we are able to understand? First thing which we are able to understand is the boundaries of the oropharynx. What is the difference between the oral cavity and oropharynx? At what point we will consider it as a oropharynx? What do you mean by the tonsillar fossa? What are the pillars of the tonsillar fossa? And what is oropharyngeal isthmus? So, this is all about the oropharynx. Thank you.